15, and to this day are expecting the Messiah to come in a cataclysmic way. Is it a historical parallel, or is Jesus really going to come out of the sky? You know, he did come down from heaven, right? No one has gone into heaven except the one who came down from heaven, the Son of Man, which is in heaven. Jesus said, I came down from heaven. Did anybody see that with their physical eye? So he will come again in the same way. He came down from heaven, but nobody saw him. History repeats itself. Look at the people who recognized Jesus. And that's the key word, recognize. Nobody followed Jesus as a result of a doctrinal conclusion. And look at this today. The most divisive issue in all of Christendom is doctrine about the second coming. How he comes, what he comes to do, when he comes. Are there events that will take place before he comes, or is his coming imminent? Will he come to set up the kingdom, or will he come after the kingdom? Will he come before the thousand-year reign, or will he come after the thousand-year reign? Or is there going to be a thousand-year reign at all? That's the most divisive issue in all of Christianity. Doctrines and doctrines and doctrines and doctrines of how the second coming will be fulfilled. But that's how it was 2,000 years ago. And Jesus came in a very unexpected way. By the way, another parallel. Jesus came out of an environment of many groups and movements who had a leader that they thought was the Messiah. Well, you can see it in Acts, 5th chapter of Acts, Gamaliel, he refers to it. That there are many groups. It's just another one. And if this is of God, you know, you can't stop it. If it is not of God, it'll pass away. There were many groups out of which Jesus was one. Of course, he was the real one. And they had to recognize Christ. And that's the key. They had to translate. Listen to this. Their responsibility, in a nutshell, was to translate their faith of expectation of Christ's coming into one of recognition. Their mistake, listen to me, saints, their mistake was they felt because they were Jews, because they had the law, and they had the scripture, that the Messiah was coming to recognize them. That was the mistake. But their responsibility was for them to recognize the Messiah, like Anna, like Simeon, like Peter. Recognize. Look at the people who recognized that Jesus was the Christ. When Jesus was a little baby, he didn't even give one sermon. Anna recognized, this is the Christ. Simeon recognized, this is a baby. And they recognized. Peter recognized. No man told you that. It was revealed to you through an internal faculty, an internal working of the Holy Spirit. Not by doctrine, not by church-approved expectation, but by an internal voice, a conviction of the Holy Spirit. The harvest is great, but the laborers were few, because not enough laborers were listening to that inner voice of conviction. That's our responsibility, brothers and sisters. God gives his word, but it's the inner voice within us, the Holy Spirit, that we pray and ask God to guide us, to lead us to that internal conviction, so that you and I together as one can fulfill our mission. We have inherited the mission of old. We are the generation that will stand in that position. That's a blessing. Or it could be a curse. But when I look around this room, and knowing you as I've come to know you, and I've known many of you before this, I praise God. Because I know in this room and in rooms like this all across this country. There are men and women that are ready, willing, and able to listen to that voice and are listening to that voice. And they're being persecuted because they're listening to that voice. But nothing will stop them. That's the power of this movement. The power of internal recognition. To hear that voice and to follow it no matter what. God bless such men and women. God bless the Second Israel. Let's pray together. Let's do our mission. Amen. Thank you. Now is the time. Now is the time. Hallelujah. Now is the time. Let's do our mission, brothers and sisters. Now is the time. Amen.